Hey Canucks fans, the NHL and the NHLPA are closing in on a brand new six-year CBA. I'm here to look at some of the important details. I'm Clay Emo, I'm at Canuck Clay on Twitter. I'm at Clayton Emo on Instagram. I'm the founder of the GLCPC, the Good Looking Canucks Positivity Club. It's my Canucks take, all in one take. It's Clay's Canucks commentary for Saturday, July the 4th. This is where you get Canucks insight that's positive and timely. Happy Independence Day, happy 4th of July to all of my American viewers, all three of you. Thank you for coming along for the ride, and I hope that you enjoy your holiday weekend in the United States of America. And one quick programming note, because it's Saturday, that means tomorrow's Sunday, that means I'm doing my weekly call out for Ask Me Anything, questions that I can answer in tomorrow's weekly vlog. So leave it in a comment below on this YouTube video. All you gotta do is start off with AMA, and you can ask me anything about the Canucks or the NHL or my personal life, and I'll choose some of the questions to answer in my vlog tomorrow. So again, looking for questions, just mark it AMA at the start. Okay, we're hearing a lot about this new CBA that the NHL and the NHLPA are closing in on, 6 years, and it could go to a player vote as early as Monday. It'll take 72 hours, so that basically takes it 3 days into Wednesday or Thursday. And then by the end of next week, we should know if this new CBA is ratified. It's 6 years, but includes this year. So this season, the 19-20 season, and then the 2021, 21-22, 22-23, 23-24, 24-25. So this would go through the 2024 to 2025 season, 6 years, including this season that we are trying to finish off, because a lot of the details, or at least some of the details, include final details on the return to play. And that would be obviously this summer, they're hoping for this summer. And so here's a few really important details. I won't go through everything. Maybe I'll do another vlog actually breaking every aspect down, but some of the more important ones, the more interesting ones to me. Number one is training camps will not open July 10 anymore. They're bumping a few days to Monday, July the 13th. That makes sense to me. It was kind of weird that training camps would start on a Friday anyways on July 10, although I'm sure they could skate through the weekend. But it looks like Monday, July the 13th is the first key date. That'll be phase three, training camps open, with everyone arriving in the hub cities, Toronto and Edmonton, by July the 26th. And then games starting on August 1st. As my son Sean said, it would be a great birthday present for him as he turns 19 on August the 2nd. But yes, that they're looking at August 1st as the first set of games in the play-in series. That would mean that the Stanley Cup would be sometime in the first week of October. Also means that the drawing for the Alexei Lafreniere sweepstakes, the qualifying team E, whoever that is, whoever's gonna win the draft lottery, we'll find out that out around August 10, and the actual real draft will come in mid-October, and the free agency November 1. So a lot of dates there, but the key ones: July 13, training camp; July 26, hub city arrival; August 1st, start playing games; August 10, find out who gets the first overall pick; mid-October, early October, Stanley Cup; mid-October, NHL draft; November 1st, NHL free agency. So there's seven important dates that to keep in mind there, and you can rest assured that we'll remind you of those dates as we continue to get closer to each of them. A few other things. Players are allowed to opt out with no penalty if they don't feel like playing in the Stanley Cup qualifiers and the playoffs this season because of health or whatever reasons, and there'll be no penalty to do so. A bit of news about the playoff share. It's being doubled from $16 million to $32 million this year. The CBA, like I said, is 6 years, so going to 2024-2025. Salary cap, this one's really important. It's gonna be set at $81.5 million, so frozen, the same as this year for next season. And then it's gonna remain there until HRR, hockey-related revenue, gets to a certain number. It's $4.8 billion. That doesn't really mean anything to us, but basically that's the amount projected for this season before the pandemic hit. So the cap will stay at $81.5 million for next year and will stay there until HRR gets back up to $4.8 billion. Once it does that, there'll be a new calculation to figure out what the salary cap will be, obviously more than $81.5 million. This is huge, right? This is a huge implications for every team, but Vancouver Canucks is a perfect example. We were hoping for a cap of $84 million, an increase by even a couple million would help. Every little dollar helps when it comes to trying to sign guys like Jacob Markstrom and Tyler Toffoli and maybe Chris Tanev and Troy Stetcher and Jake Virtanen. We know that every dollar helps, and the fact that the cap's not rising is not gonna help, because players obviously are not gonna take less money, especially unrestricted free agents. A couple other really big things: the Olympics, they're looking at participating in 2022 in Beijing and 2026 in Italy. So that's exciting news. A few other things. The escrow is a huge one, and I think I need a whole separate vlog to talk about escrow. But basically, escrow is the money that the owners hold back, the monies that are held back from player salaries to make sure that the 50-50 split of revenue between the owners and the players, it ends up being a 50-50 split. Basically, escrow is there to ensure that the players do their part in giving that money right away, because usually that it's the players that owe the owners money when it comes to making that 50-50 split. And it's a lot easier doing it that way, withholding money, than trying to get players to sign a check at the end of the season. So you hold back a certain amount of the player's paycheck, and then that's used to balance this escrow amount. Well, the fact that there's been no hockey for the past 4 months, return to play, it's gonna look completely different. We know that the hockey revenues are not gonna meet their targets, so that means the players will owe the owners some sort of money to make it a 50-50 split. So basically the whole escrow thing is the players don't like it, they recognize it's important, but what this new CBA does, it limits what percentage of the player salaries can be held in escrow. So next year it's 20%, which is huge. Then the year after that, it's 14 to 18% to be determined. Then after that, it goes to 10%. In the last 3 years of the CBA, it's only 6%. So I know it's a little complicated. It's too complicated to unpack in a quick one topic and many in a quick 10-minute vlog, but that's something we can talk about more. But the important thing to note is this CBA limits the percentage of escrow that the players have to pay into, and that's a good thing, right? They knew it was gonna be high, especially as league revenues go down this season, and it's gonna take a couple years for it to sort itself out, to return back to normal. So that's why the numbers are high, 20% next year, 14 to 18% the year after that, but then it declines very quickly after that season, 3 years from now. I think those are the most important things. There's some stuff about salary deferral and no trade and no move clauses and outlining front-loaded deals and minimum salary, but we can talk about all that, you know, down the road. I think the most important things to note are the dates, because that's the most relevant to right now. The most important thing is that it's indeed 6 years. The most important thing is that the salary cap and the escrow and the Olympics. To me, those are the big five. Again, that was the dates, escrow, salary cap, Olympics, and I just missed one. Dates, salary cap, escrow, Olympics, the term of the CBA itself being 6 years. So there's about 10 or 12 clauses, as I mentioned. I only talked about 6 to 8 of them in depth, and I think the big five are the dates, the salary cap, the escrow, the Olympics, and then the term of this, ensuring labor peace for the next 6 seasons. So Canucks fans, hockey fans, which ones stand out to you? Which ones are you all over? Which ones do you need more help in? Escrow for me. I gotta do more research. And what do you think of the dates? Do you like the dates? And are you okay with the dates of basically a Stanley Cup being awarded in the first 2 weeks of October, the draft in the middle of October, and then free agency starting on November 1st? Leave a comment below on anything you want. I guess my question of the day is, what do you think overall of this proposed 6-year CBA? And what do you like about it, and what don't you like about it? So a few questions, answer whatever you want. I'd be happy to reply and to read, react, and reply to your comments below. Also, don't forget, leave me some questions for tomorrow's vlog. Just mark it AMA for Ask Me Anything. I'll make sure I get to them when I record that vlog sometime tomorrow afternoon. In the meantime, stay safe, stay healthy, take care of yourselves, take care of each other. Like this video if you want to, subscribe to my channel if you want to. I'm off to eat dinner and then watch Hamilton on Disney+. Been waiting for this for a little while now, so maybe I'll do a quick review in my Ask Me Anything tomorrow as well. Have a great day, have a great night. God bless, and go Canucks go.